JFT Just Fair and Direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's Weekly Market Outlook webinar for the week October the 19th until October the 23rd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, Senior Market Analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the main events for this week are the UK CPIs for September, the Canadian CPIs for the same month, New Zealand's inflation numbers for the third quarter, and the preliminary PMIs from the Eurozone, the UK, and the US for October. So let's begin with Monday. Today, during the Asian session, we already got China's GDP for the third quarter, as well as the nation's industrial production, fixed asset investment, and retail sales, all for September. GDP slowed to 2.7% quarter over quarter from 11.5%, missing estimates of 3.2%, but this took the year over year rate higher to 4.9% from 3.2%. Industrial production and retail sales accelerated to 6.9% year over year, and 3.3% year over year from 5.6% and 0.5% respectively, while fixed asset investment rebounded 0.8% year over year after sliding 0.3% in August. Later in the day, we have the Bank of Canada Business Outlook survey. Now on Tuesday, US building permits and housing starts, both for September, are due to be released, and both are expected to have increased somewhat. Now on Wednesday, during the early European morning, we get the UK CPIs for September. Both the headline and core rates are expected to have increased to 0.6 and 1.3% year over year from 0.2 and 0.9% respectively. At their latest meeting, Bank of England policymakers noted that they are exploring how a negative bank rate could be implemented effectively, something that increased speculation over the adoption of sub-zero rates at one of the bank's upcoming gatherings. That said, combined with Deputy Governor Dave Ramsden's recent remarks that he and his colleagues are not about to use negative interest rates immediately, accelerating inflation may allow Bank of England officials to stay sidelined at their next gathering. The pound could gain somewhat on accelerating consumer prices, but as we noted several times in the past, most of the currency's fate will stay dependent on developments surrounding the Brexit landscape. Last week, the EU and the UK failed to make any significant progress in trade talks, with UK Prime Minister Johnson saying that the UK should get ready for a no-deal exit. That said, he stopped short of announcing that his nation will walk away from trade talks, keeping on the table hopes that a deal could still be reached before December 31st, when the transition period ends. Thus, anything suggesting that the two sides are willing to resolve their differences may support the pound, while the opposite may be true if headlines point to no narrowing of the differences gap. Now, later in the day, we get inflation data for September from Canada as well. The headline CPI rate is expected to have risen to 0.4% year over year from 0.1%, but no forecast is available for the core rate, which stood at 0.8% year over year in August. At its prior gathering, the Bank of Canada kept interest rates unchanged at 0.25%, repeating that they will stay there until the 2% inflation target is sustainably achieved. They also reiterated the view that they will continue with their QE program until the economic recovery is well underway, and that they stand ready to adjust their program if market conditions change. They said that both the global and Canadian economies are evolving broadly in line with the scenario outlined in July, but added that the bounce back in activity in the third quarter looks to be faster than anticipated in July. With all that in mind, and also taking into account that the employment report for September beat estimates, accelerating CPIs in Canada may allow Bank of Canada policymakers to continue sitting comfortably on the sidelines for a while more. So anything pointing to that the Bank of Canada is not likely to ease policy further may prove positive for the Canadian dollar, which is also dependent on the broader market sentiment. So we expect the Canadian dollar to perform relatively good if the CPIs accelerate as expected, but its broader direction is likely to depend on changes in the broader market sentiment. If we have a risk on trading, the Canadian dollar as a commodity currency is likely to benefit, but it could come under selling interest if investors abandon risk assets in favor of safe havens. Now in the US, the Senate is due to vote on a $300 billion US dollars Republican coronavirus relief bill, an amount significantly smaller than the $2 trillion demanded by Democrats. So the chances for this bill to pass are very slim. And if it fails, that could increase the probability for no accord before the November 3rd election, even as the number of coronavirus infections keeps rising at a fast pace and job growth is stalled. With the election day drawing closer, another failure to reach consensus could weigh on riskier assets like equities and the risk-linked currencies, Aussie, Kiwi, and the commodity currencies like the Canadian dollar, with investors seeking shelter in safe havens like the US dollar and the Japanese yen. Now on Thursday is a relatively light day, with the only release worth mentioning being the US existing home sales for September. The forecast points to an acceleration to 3.3% month over month from 2.4% in August. Finally, on Friday, during the Asian morning, we have New Zealand's CPI for the third quarter, but no forecast is available for neither the quarter-over-quarter rate nor the year-over-year one. At its last meeting, the RBNZ kept its official cash rate and its large-scale asset purchase program unchanged, repeating that further monetary policy stimulus may be needed in the foreseeable future, including a funding for lending program, a negative interest rate, and purchases of foreign assets. That said, recently, RBNZ Assistant Governor Christian Hawkesby said that some economic data have surprised to the upside, reducing the chances for the adoption of negative interest rates by this bank. However, he added that the discussion of negative rates is not a game of bluff, keeping the prospect well on the table. So with that in mind, and better than expected CPI may reduce the chances for policymakers acting at the next gathering scheduled for November 11th, and thereby support the QE, while a disappointment may revive some speculation for an imminent rate cut, which could result in a slide in the local currency. We get CPI data from Japan as well, but for the month of September, no forecast available for the headline rate, while the core one is anticipated to have remained unchanged at -0.4% year-over-year. A headline Tokyo rate slid to 0.2% year-over-year from 0.3%, but the core one ticked up to -0.2% year-over-year from -0.3%. This suggests that the national rates may move in a similar fashion as well. Later in the day, we get the preliminary manufacturing services and composite PMIs for October from several Eurozone nations and the bloc as a whole, the UK and the US. These data sets will give us a first taste on how the global economy has performed during the month of October, with the coronavirus keep spreading fast and hitting new record highs in daily infections. Both the Eurozone manufacturing and services PMIs are expected to have declined to 53.1 and 47 from 53.7 and 48 respectively, something that will drive the composite PMI below the boom or bust zone of 50. Specifically, the composite index is forecast to have slid to 49.5 from 50.4. So if last time we saw the services index sliding into the negative territory, sliding to 48, now another slide to 47, and a small slide in the manufacturing PMI are likely to drag the composite PMI below the 15 barrier. And this is likely to prove negative for the euro, as it will reveal that the second wave of coronavirus infections is leaving more marks on the euro area economy. In the UK, the manufacturing PMI is expected to have increased to 54.3 from 54.1, while the services one is anticipated to have declined to 55 from 56.1. This will result in a downtick in the composite PMI to 55.6 from 55.7. And with regards to the US data, the manufacturing PMI is forecast to have inched up to 53.4 from 53.2, while the services one is expected to have ticked down to 54.5 from 54.6. In the US, the PMIs are not expected to show such a bad picture as in the Eurozone. So I don't believe that the US dollar will move much if the actual prints come close to their forecasts. The UK retail sales for September are also coming out, with the headline rate expected to have slid to 0.5% month over month from 0.8%, and the core rate to have ticked down to 0.5% month over month from 0.6%. That's it from me. At this point, I would like to ask if there are any questions from your side. I will leave you a few seconds to write any questions if you have any. We don't have any questions, so that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great weekend. I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 7:30 a.m. GMT time. So goodbye and have a nice day.
JFT, just fair and direct.